We tend to talk a lot here at the lab about how Lawrence Livermore is the smartest square mile on Earth. I mean, we do have the world's most energetic laser, and our supercomputer Sierra is among the world's fastest and most powerful supercomputers. We conduct world-leading research in areas like cancer drug discovery and climate change and nuclear physics, pretty much any scientific field you could possibly think of. But work we've done here doesn't just stay inside the fence. So for this Inside the Lab, we're going to be talking about work that has gone far outside the lab to produce some of the technology that you use every day, including some really surprising things, like the mood ring. Yeah, you heard me right. While it may not actually be a piece of technology you use every day, starting off our list of the top 5 most surprising technologies to come out of Lawrence Livermore is the mood ring. You know, that quirky toy accessory that you can buy for cheap at the county fair and that supposedly informs you how you're feeling. It's actually a byproduct of scientific research done here at the lab. Here's what went down. Bob Parker was an LNL researcher studying liquid crystals. These are the same materials used to make LCD TV screens. Liquid crystals are a demonstration of a really cool state of matter, where a material as a whole behaves like a liquid, but its molecules behave like crystals. And those crystals can change conformation under different conditions, like exposure to different temperatures, for example. When the crystals change structure in response to, say, temperature, for example, their ability to absorb and refract different wavelengths of light changes, so the material as a whole changes color, which is a property called thermochromism. So Bob Parker thought these crystals were pretty freaking cool, and he started to experiment with them outside the lab, too. He actually made a bunch of stuff with thermochromic properties, like this thermometer. The numbers on the thermometer were made of this liquid crystal material and turned a certain color when exposed to their corresponding temperatures. And one day he was approached by John Reynolds, an entrepreneur whose perhaps biggest claim to fame was inventing the Thighmaster. John proposed putting this remarkable material into a jewelry setting, and voila, your favorite tourist shop trend was born. Now let's move on to number 2, which is actually something that is a little more impactful in your day-to-day than the mood ring. It actually has probably saved your life, but you've never seen it or most likely ever heard of it. It's a computer code called Dyna 3D. It was created by John O. Halquist at LNL to simulate structural engineering problems that were important for stockpile stewardship at the time. But the source code was made public in 1978, and this is an incredibly important moment in computational history because the code is so versatile. It can be used to simulate a seemingly endless variety of materials and 3D interactions, and has gone on to transform many industries, including aerospace engineering. This code was actually part of NASA's development of the Mars Pathfinder, particularly that rover's ability to use airbags during its landing on the surface of the Red Planet. But remember when I said it has probably saved your life and you didn't even know it? That's because it's used by the automotive industry to make sure that vehicle designs are as safe as they can be. The code can simulate a car's behavior during a collision, and car manufacturers then use that information to inform vehicle design. We use it to simulate all kinds of things, like the behavior of an airplane engine should a bird strike the aircraft, and it helps us design everything from new plastics to shipping containers to golf clubs to sidewalks, and it's still used here at the lab. Dyna 3D was the precursor to AL3D, a simulation code we still use here at LNL to understand the complex behavior of materials under extreme conditions. Number 3 brings us to another life-saving application, but this time in the field of medicine. Did you know that we can paint chromosomes? See, chromosomes are where our cells store our DNA. It's all wrapped up and twisted tightly into these structures. And humans typically have 23 chromosomes in almost all of our cells. But when something goes wrong with our chromosomes, something can go really wrong in our bodies. Like, for example, when our cells divide, they have to make copies of our chromosomes to give to the new cell. And sometimes, that copy isn't perfect. Bits of one chromosome can end up on an entirely different chromosome where they're not supposed to be. This is a mistake called translocation. Chromosome painting is a technique developed by two Livermore scientists that allows different chromosomes to be made to fluoresce different colors, so we can easily identify them and actually see those mistakes like translocation. This has allowed for better identification of diseases, like specific cancers and genetic abnormalities that are associated with very specific chromosomal abnormalities, so that people can get the right treatment for their illness as soon as possible. Chromosome painting has continued to develop over the last few decades and is now called fluorescence in situ hybridization, or FISH, and is one of the most important techniques used today for diagnosis and management of genomic diseases. Something that's helping us look a little further into the future is number 4, an innovative system designed to help self-driving cars see by themselves. The current technology used by most autonomous vehicles is called light detection and ranging, or LiDAR, which uses a pulsed laser to measure distances and then generate maps by which cars can navigate. But there's a problem with this option. This technology is bulky to carry around and can't identify specific single objects. And it takes a long time for the car to sort through all of the data about the surroundings to generate the map. Livermore's solution is called the Light Field Directing Array, or LDA, which combines precision engineering and 3D printing on the micro scale to make a system of miniature mirrors that are constantly moving. As they move in unison, they can capture light bouncing off of everything in the environment, and they essentially are behaving like a single, larger device would. And they can amass detailed information about environmental conditions and objects as the car is moving. Researchers think that LDA tech could let autonomous vehicles locate and avoid objects more rapidly and from a greater distance, bringing us just that little bit closer to a safer, better future for self-driving cars. And last on our list, but certainly not least, I have a question for you. Have you used Google Maps recently to get from point A to point B? Because I used it today, and that's thanks to, you guessed it, Lawrence Livermore. Sure, Google Maps is one of the places that global satellite imagery is aggregated, but where do those images come from? They're taken by satellite networks, many of which are based on work that originated here at the lab. What started as research into satellite technology as part of a defense program initiative quickly became useful for civilian applications too. The company that resulted from this LNL-based work doesn't just provide satellite images to Google Maps. Their imagery can also be used to help tailor emergency response and relief, to develop new communities using a better understanding of the past and present conditions in a given area, and to optimize communications networks for the telecoms of the future. I had such a hard time choosing what to cover in this video, you guys. This is just a small handful of Livermore technologies that have changed the world and will continue to do so in the future. There are so many more that we could talk about, so would you like to see another edition of this surprising things to come out of the lab? Let us know down in the comments below or over on our social media channels. We are at Livermore Lab everywhere you can find us. I've left some resources down in the description of this video if you want to learn more about stuff like this in the meantime, and make sure you subscribe to this YouTube channel to catch even more videos about awesome lab technology. Check out our whole Inside the Lab playlist to catch up on any episodes you may have missed, and as always, thank you so much for watching. I'll see you next time.